Hello, welcome again to our lecture course on relativity and cosmology. We deal with foundations of cosmology. And last time I argued that we have at least to first order deal with spaces, space-time at a constant time, spaces of constant curvature. The reason for this was twofold, first empirically and second mathematically. And the third, well, even the third reason physically. So observationally, we have isotropy from our vantage point. Then we use physically a principle to say that the view is the same from every point in space. So there's no preferred position. This is called the cosmological principle, and it's very important and very central in cosmology. And the third is then mathematics, showing that this leads to a space of constant curvature. And I have then derived, or I should say I have sketched the derivation, not filled out the details, that led to this spatial line element. I mean, here still, well, this is for three dimensions here, this here, but this is general for n dimensions, n-dimensional space. We have this conformally flat structure of the metric. So this is just the Euclidean metric, but we have this factor here, which depends on B. So B, if B is zero, we have flat space. But if B is non-zero, we can distinguish according to the sign of B, which can be, I mean, positive or negative. So this K can be positive or negative, plus one or minus one, and depending on that we have a different form of the metric. Okay, so next time we will extend this to space-time. That will be the so-called Robertson-Walker line element, where we will see that we just have a minus dt squared in addition. So then we have minus dt squared plus this here, and in the exercises you're already invited right now to study, I mean, the Robertson-Walker metric and derive the field equations. But for us here in the lecture course, let me today still restrict to space and give you some insight into the geometric meaning. So what I have here prepared for 12.3.3.2 is the geometric realization of spaces with constant curvature. So it will turn out that basically, as you will see, at least locally, you have the options of having a sphere, a pseudosphere, or a flat space. Let me discuss in more detail the case of positive B and be very brief then later for B negative. And what I will show here is that, and let us do it for generality in n dimensions, that n-dimensional space can be embedded in a Euclidean space. This will play the role of an auxiliary space only of dimension n plus 1 as a sphere. Yeah. So that means a kind of super observer who lived in n plus 1 flat dimensions. So this super observer could then see this geometry that we deal with as an n-dimensional sphere, but only for the visualization. No? We don't talk about embeddings in a realistic sense. This is just for illustrating and visualization. Now, okay, the sphere, let us call it S rho, well, or S rho n more precisely. But I skip the n, it's an n-dimensional sphere, which is embedded in Rn plus 1, and this is defined as a set of all x bar in Rn plus 1, such that the sum of the squared is constant. The sum of I equals 1 to n plus 1, x bar I squared, is a constant, and the constant I call rho squared, and I also introduce here quantity b, and this will then be the same b as later, but for here it's just a definition. This is 1 over rho squared. Now this is a sphere with radius rho in this embedding. So more precisely, I should call it Sn rho. It's the n-dimensional surface of an n plus one dimensional ball. I mean, you all know that the S2, and we will then later have to deal with S3, but here we have Sn. And the metric on this is the one that is induced by the Euclidean metric of the embedding space. So metric, I should say, metric on S rho is the one induced by the Euclidean metric of n plus 1. Now, I mean, to derive, I mean, that the line element on the sphere has this form, I need, I mean, intrinsic coordinates on the sphere. No? So that's what the main effort is devoted to. And of course, I could do this in principle many ways. It turns out to be convenient to use so-called stereographic projection or stereographic coordinates that you certainly know from other contexts in physics, where we have a sphere put on a plane, and then you have, I mean, you make a line from the north pole through the sphere and to the plane, and then you can relate the coordinates. So let me do it in this way. So stereographic projection. So I assume that I have the sphere, and then I will derive this line element so that we can identify the two. So let me give a diagram. Of course, an n plus one dimension is not so easy to draw, but I think you understand the following. So I put here the n plus first coordinate, and here this is an n-dimensional space here or symbolizer. So I have here 1 up to n, and so so the sphere is maybe sitting here. So that's the S rho, and I call this distinguished point. I mean, of course, I can use the North Pole, and so I draw then here a line here to this. So this is then called. This is then my x alpha. Okay, the x alphas will then be the coordinates here. No? Without the bar, use x alpha as coordinates on S rho. No? And so I have here, of course, now this has coordinates in the embedding space. So this here is then x bar alpha, x bar n plus 1. So let me maybe use the color so to indicate here that's the radius. I mean, that's just a cross section through the sphere radius. And let me also consider this triangle here, this here, and the big triangle, and here a smaller triangle that will be shaded here with color. And I need finally also an angle phi. So the following is elementary geometry. So alpha is 1 to n. So let us consider, I mean, the two triangles. So the tangents of phi, this ratio of this to this, so that's rho over x alpha. Now that's here. That if you go to the shaded triangle, then you can also take this to this, which is x bar n plus 1, n plus 1 to x alpha minus x bar alpha. Now, and from this, I get that x bar alpha is x alpha times 1 minus x bar n plus 1 over rho. Now let me call this equation star, because this I will need later. And the next I will derive the x bar n plus 1 as a function of x alpha. So next, that's what I do now. So I will have x bar n plus 1 as a function of x alpha and rho. So how do I do that? Well, I use the definition here of the sphere. So from this, I mean, I will divide this up into a sum up to n, and then I will the n plus first write separately. So if you have, so the S rho is the sum of I equals 1 to n plus 1 x bar I squared is rho squared. So as I said, I write this as a sum of alpha 1 to n x bar alpha squared plus x bar n plus 1. So this is trivially. Now I use here the star, equation star here. So which means that this term is a 1 minus x bar n plus 1 over rho squared, the sum of x alpha squared, alpha equal 1 n, and this here I will call r squared. Okay, it will then be more or less that here I should have written also alpha, but it will then be later related to this, or be identical to that. So just let me write this algebraically in the following way. So I mean, from this we have that 1 minus, I mean, x bar n plus 1 over rho squared, r squared, is the rho squared minus x bar n plus 1 squared. Yeah, I mean, this is rho squared minus this to the other side. Trivially, I can write this as rho squared, and I have 1 minus x bar n plus 1 over rho squared is a rho squared 1 plus x bar n plus 1 over rho 1 minus x bar n plus 1 over rho. Okay, so we have these two sides here of this equation. Now we assume that this here is non-zero. This would mean that we exclude here the North Pole itself. That's a usual singular position, because if you had here, I mean, you could not make a stereographic projection here. Yeah. So we assume x bar n plus 1 is not equal to rho, so North Pole excluded. So we can divide by this. So divide by 1 minus x bar plus 1 over rho. So if we do that, I mean, I continue here, then we have here 1 minus x bar n plus 1 over rho r squared is rho squared 1 plus x bar n plus 1 rho, from which you get x bar n plus 1 is rho times r squared minus rho squared over r squared plus rho squared. No? So that's what we wanted. So to have x bar n plus 1 as a function of x alpha and rho. We call this equation 1. If we insert this here into the equation star, so we see here we have x bar n plus 1, and here also, so we insert this here at that equation. So insert this into star, then we get that x bar alpha is x alpha times 1 minus x bar n plus 1 over road is just copied from what I had earlier. And if I do that, then I have 2 rho squared over r squared plus rho squared times x alpha. And that's the equation 2. No? So you see, we have now expressed x bar, the x bars, all of them, I mean the first n's and the n plus first, in terms of the unbared, of the intrinsic coordinates, which are in r squared, and the size of the sphere. So instead, let me formulate it. So instead of embedding coordinates with a constraint, namely that we have the sphere, we have now intrinsic coordinates without constraint. No? So instead of n plus 1 embedding coordinates with the constraint that the sum of all the x bar I squared from I 1 to n plus 1 is equal to rho squared, we now have n intrinsic coordinates x alpha on s rho without constraint. Now, and this is what we want. We have the embedding space with Euclidean coordinates, and we have that curved embedded space, and we want to use then the intrinsic coordinates on that embedded space. And we have constructed them by stereographic projection. Now, we want to finally check that we get this line element. Now, when we have the coordinates, so the induced metric on S rho. So we write that the sum of I equals 1 to n plus 1 dx bar I squared. This is the sum of alpha equal 1 to n dx bar alpha squared plus dx bar n plus 1 squared. And so using equations 1 and 2, I mean, we calculate here the differentials and insert that here. No? So replace these two, replace with dx alpha squared terms by using 1 and 2. And that's a trivial exercise, and let me just give the result. So if from equation 1 you calculate the differentials, I mean rho is of course a constant, so you only have to take r squared calculate its differential. I'm using that r squared is the sum of the x alpha squared, so 1 you get dx bar n plus 1 is rho squared times 4 rho r dr over r squared plus rho squared squared. And from 2, then we get a dx alpha bar. Dx bar alpha is 2 rho squared. And then you have here r squared plus rho squared dx alpha minus 2 x alpha r dr r squared plus rho squared squared. So what do we get then? I mean, so we insert this here into this line element. So then, I mean, from this, then we get that the sum of I equals 1 to n plus 1 dx bar I squared is, also we use r squared as the sum of the x alpha squared to replace dr by d alpha. We have here the dr, but we want to have the d alpha, so use also r squared is the sum of the dx alpha squared alpha 1 to n. And what you get then is a 4 rho to the 4 r squared plus rho squared squared. And we have the sum of alpha equals 1 to n d x alpha squared. So we are almost at the end. We have to do some trivial steps to find the identical form. So let us make a rescaling x alpha going to x alpha over 2, I mean, to get rid of this factor of 4. And so then we have that, I mean, the sum here of the dx bar I squared is then 1 over 1 plus r squared over 4 rho squared squared sum over alpha equals 1 to n dx alpha squared. And we now introduce the b. Here b is 1 over rho squared. So b is 1 over rho squared, so then we have 1 over 1 plus b over 4 r squared squared, and the sum of alpha equals 1 to n dx alpha squared. And you see that's directly our dl squared. So you see here, that's, if you have a look here, yeah, that's here directly this line element. So what we have shown here, that actually, I mean, what we, I mean, the space of the line element for a space of constant curvature with k equals plus 1 or b positive can be realized as by the geometry of a sphere to be embedded in a Euclidean space. No, so that's the dl squared from above. So we have seen that for positive b, which means k equals plus 1, this line element can be realized by embedding a sphere into an auxiliary Euclidean space. Now the same can be done, or similar thing can be done, for the case b negative, and I will not go into the details, but I have to mention a subtlety. So as it turned out, and the mathematicians have proved this for us, no smooth embedding is possible into a Euclidean space of one higher dimension. So here the mathematicians tell us that no smooth embedding is possible into a Euclidean space Rn plus 1. It is possible, though, to embed in a higher dimensional space, and it was shown that this is always possible, but not in just one higher dimension. But the embedding is possible into an Rn plus 1 if you adopt a Minkowski signature for Rn plus 1 instead of Euclidean signature. No? But it is possible for Minkowski signature, which means Rn plus 1 with Minkowski signature. Now, this means the following, and the space is often called H rho, which is in Rn plus 1. And so the space of constant curvature that is embedded in Rn plus 1 with Minkowski signature is defined as the set of all x bar such that the sum alpha equals 1 to n x bar alpha squared minus x bar n plus 1 squared is minus rho squared. Now, so you have this hyperbolic structure, and the H refers to this hyperbolic, also called a hyperbolic space. So that's what one can show, and this is called a pseudosphere. Well, it's a bit of not very original name, because I mean, with the other signatures, a sphere, and people called it pseudo. Or particle physicists, they also call it mass shell, as you know, yeah, because this is what you have in momentum space, p squared equal m squared. We had this before. Now, actually, this consists of two simply connected hyperboloids. So we have this. Actually, let me sketch. So we have this light constructor, because we have Minkowski signature, and then we have these two hyperboloids here and here. Oh, so you have these two mass shells. Yeah, the asymptote here. And I should say one can, to some extent, embed it in this Euclidean space, but only in a non-smooth way. This is a picture that you sometimes see in for the pseudosphere. It looks like that. It has here some edge, so it goes here to infinity, and it has here, yeah, so here, this kind of structure. I mean, it's not nicely drawn here, but you can view nice pictures in the literature. No, so it has this, so it has here a singularity. Then with that singularity, you can embed the pseudosphere into Rn plus 1. But let us do here, this is, I mean, much, much more convenient. So a calculation analogous to the one for k equals plus 1, we use the same stereographic coordinates, in fact, gives us similar equations to what we had before as 1 and 2. Recall we had expressed x bar n plus 1 and x bar alpha in terms of r squared and rho squared. And let me just give the results. So an indicated difference. So if you compare with above, we have rho, and we have here r squared, then here a plus rho squared, and the differences are entirely due to these differences here in signature. And here we have r squared minus rho squared 1 prime, and here we have here a minus, and we have here 2 rho squared over r squared plus rho squared x alpha. So if you compare in your manuscript or on the screen with the earlier equations, they look very similar but have here different signs. Now from this we then calculate the sum of alpha 1 to n d x bar alpha squared, and we have here the minus sign, minus d x bar n plus 1 squared. Then follows that we have here the sum of d x alpha squared, alpha equals 1 to n, 1 plus b over 4 r squared squared, with b defined as minus 1 over rho squared negative. No? So you see, again, this has the form of this line element, space of constant curvature, but now with negative curvature. No? And we have here k equals minus 1. So to summarize, b equals 0 is anyway flat space. I don't have to treat this differently. So the n-dimensional Riemannian spaces of constant curvature are locally isometric to the n-dimensional sphere, pseudosphere of flat space. So summary, so the n-dimensional Riemannian spaces of constant curvature with b is 1 over rho squared, so respectively b is minus 1 over rho squared and b is 0 are locally isometric to the n-dimensional sphere or pseudosphere, this value of flat space. So that's what we have shown. I mean, in detail for the positive case, and as a summary for the negative case and for the flat case, it's already there. Just a remark, I mean, these spaces S row and H row, they are spaces of maximal symmetry. Therefore, they have the maximum number of Killing fields, which in three dimensions would be 3. So S row, so remark, S row and H row are spaces of maximal symmetry. Not surprising, I mean, if you have constant curvature and this homogeneity, this is very special maximal symmetry, and thus possess n times n plus 1 over 2 independent Killing fields. And of course, for our case, which is n equals 3, this is equal to 6. So 6 Killing fields. I emphasize here, I mean, locally isometric, because everything is here infinitesimal. No? So you might imagine whether you could have something different than, say, the sphere, which has the same local line element, but globally looks different. And the global structure, as I emphasized long time before, is not determined by Einstein equations. They are differential equations. So the global structure or the topology can be different. So do we know what the other possibilities we have? Well, at least we know that if we restrict to simply connected spaces, that then more or less this is unique. No? So I quote the following. I should write down global structure not determined. Global structure, topology, not determined. No, that's important. So, but if we restrict ourselves to simply connectedness, I quote a theorem. I mean, this is a subfield of mathematics, and so I will not enter proofs, any proofs. So two simply connected spaces of the same constant curvature are globally isomorphic to each other. Yeah, this means there are no additional global topological degrees of freedom. Of course, S row directly is simply connected. H row consists of two simply connected pieces, so in this sense also it holds. Of course, the question is whether there are other, I mean, simply connected spaces with the same metric, or whether they are already unique. So the uniqueness was proved long ago, except for the positive case. So this is maybe an interesting side story from mathematics. So there was this Poincaré conjecture long ago by the famous mathematician Poincaré, that for three dimensions, which is the relevant one for us, that the three sphere is the only finite simply connected three manifold. And this was only proved in 2002 by Grigori Perelman, who was awarded the Fields Medal 2006, but he declined it. Perhaps you know that story. So in fact, S3 is the only option for simply connected three-dimensional manifolds. I will not write this down. Okay, but what if we relax this condition of being simply connected, do we know what else we have, as what options there are? This is a field by itself, and I will not enter it. But let me just give you an example in two dimensions. No? So if we have two dimensions and flatness, of course, then the simply connected case is the plane. But there are others. And in fact, here we have five possibilities. That's relatively easy. five possibilities. And in higher dimensions, we have similar versions, but it's much more complicated. No? So in these five possibilities, they are the plane. That's the simply connected case. But there's also, I mean, you can, the plane, I mean, extend, you can form this to move this to form a cylinder, infinite cylinder, which has the same intrinsic geometry. So it's also intrinsically flat. So that's the cylinder. And this you do by identifying, I mean, two edges. You can also, in addition, identify the other edges, and then you find a so-called torus, which is a finite space. You can also identify this, I mean, with opposite. I will not do experiments here with my manuscript, but with opposite corners. And then you get this famous Möbius strip that you can entertain yourself on the internet with Möbius strips. So Möbius strips, which is non-orientable. And if you do that, I mean, also then with the other edges, and but also, I mean, to the opposite, then you find something very weird called the Klein bottle, which is closed and non-orientable. Closed and non-orientable. So in higher dimensions, you have many more possibilities. For example, in three dimensions, which is the relevant case for us, you have a part from S3. Also, you can take the S3 with opposite points identified. You have the so-called Poincaré dodecahedral, I mean, which looks a little bit like a football. And this was some time ago used also as a model of the universe, although it was from the data not confirmed. And many others. So in higher dimensions, you have many more possibilities. Of course, you also have, I mean, analogs here to the torus and so on, and to the Klein bottle. And of course, you can distinguish between finite and infinite spaces and so on. The point for us here in physics is that the theory that we have, Einstein's theory, does not determine the topology. So given the present state of physics, we can only determine it by observations. So I will not enter this too much in my lecture course, but so far from observation, there is no clear evidence that the topology is non-trivial. That is, it's not the sphere, pseudosphere, or just the R3. But it's possible that we live in a torus, say, and that perhaps with some future measurements we can determine that. I mean, it's clear if you are on a torus, then of course there is a finite path for light, and you can identify certain structures because you can look in the direction, but you can also look the other way and so on. So people look for such repetitions, but have so far not found anything. Historically, this was discussed very early, I mean, long before relativity, because this is about space. So even if you don't know about space-time and so on, you can think about non-trivial topology for space. And actually, our famous Schwarzschild, that you know from the Schwarzschild solution, already wrote a paper in the year 1900, where he thought about this topological non-trivial possibility. So his paper is called Über das zulässige Krümmungsmaß des Raumes. From the title, you will not directly see that it's about this topology thing, about the admissible curvature measure of space. And for him, of course, the universe at that time was the Milky Way. And he investigated mathematically these options and came to the conclusion from the data of that time that there's no hint for non-trivial topology. I mean, with observations of the Milky Way, which is certainly correct. Let me give you one reference where you've about this from lecture notes by Rebukas this summarizes the state of affairs in 2005, but it's more or less, you can use this as an introduction, and so far we have no further data that give a hint for non-trivial topology. And here you can also have references to the mathematical literature, also to textbooks in mathematics, in case you're interested in the non-trivial topology of the universe. Okay, so far for 12.3, now we also have to discuss the metric for space-time, because we are in an expanding universe. So this is only about space, so space at a given time should be of constant curvature. But what about space-time? And this will lead us to the so-called Robertson-Walker metric, and if we insert this into the Einstein equations, we find what we call the Friedmann-Lemaître equations. So let us go on, and let us go from space to space-time. So the next section is devoted to the derivation of the space-time metric, and of one important consequence at a kinematic level before we enter the dynamics, the cosmic redshift, which is the most important tool to actually explore observationally our universe. Now, so far, we have seen that using both observations, the cosmological principle and the mathematical theorems, we arrive at spaces of constant curvature. So this is relevant for a universe at a given time. But what about space-time? So that's the question here. So we have, of course, space. So we have spaces of constant curvature. And these spaces, they are homogeneous and isotropic. So let us formulate homogeneity and isotropy of spaces from the point of view of space-time. So we first have then the homogeneity of space. Mathematically, it means that there exists a one-parameter family of space-like hypersurface in space-time, so each at a constant time, which foliates space-time and whose elements are homogeneous. Of course, you can have another foliation into non-homogeneous spaces. That's clear if you make very weird foliations. But the point is, if you have homogeneous space, then at any time, then space-time should be foliated into these hypersurfaces. No, so that means there exists a one-parameter family of space-like hypersurfaces. Let me call them sigma t in space-time. So this means constant t. So this, of course, distinguishes a certain coordinate constant t in space-time, which foliate space-time and whose elements are homogeneous. Mathematically, homogeneous means there is an isometry of the spatial metric, so that for any two points, P and Q, on sigma t, you can map P into Q isometrically. Okay, second, the isotropy of space. Okay, this means there is no preferred direction. So let us consider a congruence of time-like curves, like that, which represent observers. So let us call them fundamental world lines. Weyl called this substratum geodesics, and so representing observers. So we have here at any point, of course, the four velocity of the observer. So whom u is a distinguished four velocity. Now in cosmology, it means at rest with the cosmic microwave background, and it corresponds to a co-moving observer. Also in cosmology, at rest with respect to the cosmic microwave background, because this gives you, for our universe, of course, a distinguished system. And if you move with respect to the CMB, you can detect it. I mean, actually, we do detect the motion of the Earth through the CMB, or the motion of the Earth together with our surrounding, by having a dipole in it. So only if you are addressed with respect to the CMB, you are a co-moving observer. Now, we have here, okay, that's point P, say, let us consider two tangential vectors orthogonal to U. So we have here S1 mu, S2 mu. So these are, so S1 mu, S2 mu, they are spatial tangential vectors orthogonal to U mu. Now, isotropy means that for every point P, and for any two such vectors, S1 and S2, there's an isometry of the metric where, I mean, P is fixed, and also U mu is fixed, but S1 and S2, or S1 is rotated, say, into S2, so which means there's no geometrically preferred tangential vector. Now, that's, I mean, what we intuitively think about also isotropy. I mean, you have these two directions, and if we rotate one to the other, we have an isometry, so the metric is the same. So isotropy means there is no geometrically preferred tangential vector orthogonal to U. Of course, this only holds for the co-moving observer, because otherwise you have a distinguished direction, say with respect to the CMB, which you can observe. Well, and it's clear then from this that the homogeneous surfaces, then, I mean, they must be orthogonal to these world lines, and only then, I mean, can you rotate this into each other and have, I mean, the same spatial geometry. So from this you find that the homogeneous surfaces sigma t must be orthogonal to the world lines. Yeah, because if not, otherwise you could construct a geometrically preferred spatial vector. So the picture that we have of that foliation is so like that. So you have here a space and here, say, next one. So maybe that's a sigma t, and this is a sigma t plus delta t, and you have the world lines here, say here, and so on. And so you have here the orthogonal, and all of these are homogeneous spaces. No? So we have here for this world line x1, x2, x3 is equal constant. So we have fixed coordinates, and we just move in time, we are co-moving, and x0, which we also call t, is tau plus constant, and the tau is the proper time along the world line. I mean, this, if we adopt these coordinates for space-time, we call them also Gaussian or synchronous coordinates. So these are Gaussian or synchronous coordinates. And yeah, from this, in this coordinate system, we can directly write down the space-time line element. And let me do this here. So then the space-time line element, because the spatial part we have already derived in the last section. So we can write that we have dt squared is then the temporal part is just minus dt squared, because this just corresponds to the proper time for co-moving observer. Now, if you are co-moving, the spatial coordinates do not change, and we just have the proper time, and we can use this as the coordinate time t. We don't have to, of course, but we do that. And then we have a spatial part with a function a squared of t dab dxa dxb, where this part is what we had before, space of constant, and this is we had also the scale factor before, but without time dependence, and now we include this time dependence because the a is different in general from each moment to the other. So that's what we have here. So a of t is a scale factor or expansion factor, and hab, which depends on x1, x2, x3, is the spatial metric. Okay, the part of the spatial metric apart from the scale factor, which has here been written down separately, and this is the line element of the space of constant curvature. Now, so it describes spaces of constant curvature, which we dealt with in the last section. So, which means that if we write this down explicitly, then we have ds squared is minus dt squared plus a squared of t dr squared over 1 minus k r squared plus r squared d omega squared. And this line element is often called Robertson-Walker line element after two US American mathematicians. So that's Robertson-Walker line element. Nowadays, I mean, we will see that when we derive Einstein field equations that from that metric, we call it Friedmann-Lemaître equation. In the more recent literature, people often write FLRW for everything, which means Friedmann-Lemaître, Robertson-Walker, so you should not be surprised to see that. I mean, Robertson-Walker, this is the RW, and this means Friedmann-Lemaître, Robertson-Walker. Now, so I will continue to say Robertson-Walker line element and Friedmann-Lemaître equations, but that may be a matter of taste, and this FLRW seems to be an acronym frequently used, or FLRW models. If you read about FLRW model, then of course you have a model in mind with such a metric. So as I said, the isotropy is defined with respect to the cosmic microwave background, and one can prove, and this is the last thing for today, so one can prove the so-called EGS theorem, named after Ehlers, Gehren, and Sachs, 1968, that relate that really to the observations. What do they prove? They prove the following: if our family of freely falling observed, the CMB is everywhere exactly isotropic, space-time is described by the Robertson-Walker line element. Yeah. So this means you can actually justify this here directly from observations of the CMB. So if for a family of freely falling observers, the CMB is everywhere exactly isotropic, space-time is described by the Robertson-Walker line element. And definitely since the decoupling of radiation in the early universe, that's true, so we can point to that theorem, I mean, to justify this, at least for first approximation. Now the CMB, as I told you in the historic introduction, is not precisely isotropic. And so the question is whether this theorem remains true under small perturbations. Yeah, and this was shown by by Stöger, Martens, and George Ellis in 1995, that this remains true if you write almost isotropic and almost RW. So the theorem remains true if one writes almost isotropic and almost RW. It's just a side remark, I mean, where you can further justify the use of this line element, at least as a first approximation to the geometry. Okay, that's all for today. Next time we continue with that section. So I will give some further illustrations of that, of the meaning of this line element. We will also use other coordinates that are frequently used in cosmology. And then we discuss the important concept of cosmic redshift, which you can directly calculate from the Robertson-Walker line element. So thank you for today and until next time.